Good evening. I'm going to convene the town council meeting for November 5th, 2020. If everybody would please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, and then remain standing for a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I want to welcome everybody. First item of business here is a review of the minutes from the past meeting. We have the reorg meeting minutes from October 15th, 2020. Anybody have any changes or a motion to approve?
Take a motion to approve.
Second?
Second.
We have a motion to approve and a second to approve the minutes from October 15th, 2020 reorg meeting. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Next, we have Citizens Forum. Just to kind of set the tone here for when we do vote, I think we can do an oral vote is pretty much the way we can go about doing these things. If there is going to be a dissent, I may actually also call for a show of hands. So I think that'll help us out, and it'll certainly help out Carolyn as well. Next, we have Citizens Forum. I don't have anybody written down, but I believe, Elaine, that you're coming in for Citizens Forum. Yeah? Before you do that, let's have you, and while you're setting up, maybe Carolyn can read the statement. Mm-hmm. Do we have anybody, by the way, that's emailed in, or we're still doing that? Okay.
Welcome to this meeting of the Centreville Town Council. This is a public meeting, and we welcome your participation. By attending, you acknowledge that this session is recorded and aired live on QACTV 7. During the meeting, we ask that you turn your cell phones off and hold personal conversations outside the meeting room. The scheduled agenda is available on the information table just outside. Public comment will be limited to 3 minutes per person. The Town Council respects and appreciates your desire and right to convey your message freely. And in keeping with the dignity of proceedings, we ask that all views be expressed in a respectful and civil manner. Comments longer than 3 minutes should be submitted in writing. If questions are a part of your comments, we will refer those to the appropriate individual. Thank you.
Thank you. If you would just, please, for the record, state your name and your address. And
hi, my name is Elaine Studley, and I live at 201 South Liberty, two blocks away. So I wanted to come in and talk to you all because the Legacy Foundation is going to be doing activities on the square during the whole month of December. Now, our board actually hasn't voted on this, but I wanted to make sure that we got in front of you guys so that nobody was surprised when little old ladies in beautiful costumes show up on the square. And there are some things that we need permission on, but for the most part, it's just activities that are going to be occurring. I also thought I should introduce us, because we have, like most of the organizations that serve the town, we have been dormant for the last 6 months, and now we're in a part into strategic planning, and we'd kind of like to let you know who we are, because probably by spring, we'll be back in front of you proposing activities for town. Okay, for those of you who have never heard of us, we're known for tours and events and activities in the downtown. We were started as an economic development group, and I'll show you our mission. If you were with us last year at all, I know Tim was, we've run tours twice. We've run a number of small tours. We run educational programs in the downtown. The whole objective is to attract folks to the downtown. This is our actual mission. It's community building, historic branding, and economic development in Queen Anne's Central County, and really it is the county seat that we're interested in. The reality is that we are so different economically from Kent Island that I really felt when I was working on the CETA program that we could use an adjunct group to support the town center. And we create funding to sustainable, inclusive downtown events programs, and we also write and give grants. So these are the grants that we've won. We are only about 18 months old. These are the grants we've won and given in the last 18 months. We won a grant and helped with the restoration of Tucker House. We worked on the facade of Wright's Chance, and that grant was actually given by the town of Centreville. We did a Stories of the Chesapeake grant for the virtual docent program. I'm not going to go into that, but essentially it's holographic docents to attract people to the museums. We also have a commissioner's grant for community events that's helped to underwrite our community events. We have been profitable since day one. We're a nonprofit, but I still see things in terms of profit. The grants that we have given, we have helped out with Main Street. We're not rich, but we've done okay. And we've helped out with Main Street with the historic restoration of the lamps. We've helped with a contribution to the trees. We've provided matching funds and in-kind labor for the restoration of Tucker House, and then funds for the lighting of the facade of Wright's Chance. So those are some of the accomplishments of last year. We are a 100% volunteer, self-funded, no overhead, modern virtual organization. We have no desire whatsoever to have a building, and 100% of the proceeds from our foundation go immediately back into the community in terms of events and grants for restoration. One of our mentors has been the Avalon Foundation, which started with $10,000 about 25 years ago, and they started by doing activities in downtown Easton. Oops, sorry, I tried to get this in 3 minutes. I'll go keep going. So these are some of the groups we partner with: CETA, Centreville Main Street Program. We go back and forth and share programs with them and support them as well. All right. One of the concerns we actually had a project ongoing, and we're buying product for that project right now, which is the reason why I wanted to get in here tonight. We're actually buying some of the product for this. We're losing some of the beloved traditions, and among them our own. Our tours are being lost this year, our parade and our concerts are all being lost, and we really feel concerned for how the children view Christmas. And so we kind of all put our heads together to find out how we could do a virtual or a kind of event that was a non-event. So one of the goals is to add a bit of magic to the square for the entire month of December to see if we can't get people walking to the square, increase walkability. Part of it will be a celebration of lights. We're going to try and talk our homeowners into doing more light decoration and to decorating their porches more, so that if you drive downtown, you see more going on in the center of town. We will do the annual porch decoration competition with prizes. We did this last year and it was a lot of fun. We will do it again and see if we can't ramp it up. All of the store owners either contributed or we bought prizes for this. And then we will have Saturday magic on the square. And that's historic characters, usually for a few hours a day walking around the square, small gifts for children of all cultures. We will be giving out the first bell of Christmas with a story, but we will also be giving out Kwanzaa beads and we will be giving out dreidels. Small gifts for children, historic cars. The Chesapeake Bay Motoring Festival will be contributing. We'll have a historic, at least one, if not two, and that's Luke Phipps, who will be contributing cars to the downtown. We will have a new supply of the ornaments, and that's the reason we went and visited with planning yesterday to see if the ornaments worked for that, and we will be adding them. Fresh swags for all of the historic lamps, and we have a new partner in this. Murdoch is actually going, they're just going to do for the cost of labor, they're going to be adding swags to all of the historic lamps for us. And future ideas are garland for the stores and repair to the stars. We know that right now we do not have adequate time to do everything we'd like to do, and so those are the two things that we at least have tentatively eliminated yesterday in discussions. But we would love, there are stars that on each of the streets, on the poles, and a good number of them are broken. We would love to be able to donate to get them repaired. Okay, so that's just that activity. This is one we have eliminated, but it's a thought. And this is a rendering of the downtown. I'm a graphic artist, so I did a rendering of the downtown. We now have a massive advantage in the wider sidewalk, and that is that the wider sidewalk gives you a better view of the buildings. If you turn to the center square, you get this absolutely gorgeous, perfect architectural view. If you turn to our buildings on the street, they're not quite as connected, and there are many ways that we can work on that and help. But one of the things we talked about contributing possibly next year would be greenery to the stores in the same manner that Annapolis does. The only thing is that this would take time and money to test before December. If you all were dying for the idea, we would jump on it and do it. But the reality is that there's probably about $600 worth of garland in there, and if we got the size wrong, it would be a rather expensive mistake. So that's just one of the other ideas. We just wanted to let you know we're here. One of the things we'd like to be able to do, the real motivation behind this was knowing that we're heading into a tough economy, and a separate group that can lend grants and help the downtown, we think will make a big difference. Main Street does a lot, and we work with them a lot, but the reality is that having the funding to answer to a grant immediately and say yes to it would be great.
Thank you. Any other questions? Anybody have any questions? Also, just thanks, Elaine. You know, regarding the citizens forum, this is the first meeting that we've had with me as president. I do just want to set the tone that, you know, we will do our best to answer questions if there are questions, much like we've always done in the past year, that we've done for the past several years. If there are, you know, long comments or long questions, we would have to ask that we provide those in writing, and we'll get answers back. And if it is something of a technical nature, we'll provide those answers in writing as well. No other citizens forum. I'm going to move on to new business. We have AMWIN's voluntary retiree healthcare program. Crystal, I believe that's you.
It is. Good evening.
Good evening.
So I attended a virtual seminar with Legit in October, and one of the things that they had brought up, and they brought it up in the past, but it's something I think at the time we just didn't have a chance to approach, but this is a Legit sponsored program called AMWINS, and it's a voluntary retiree healthcare program. So our healthcare is currently brokered through Benecon, which is also supported through Legit. And it's a health co-op. However, they don't offer group plans for retirees. And so this is an opportunity for employees to be able to look into future Medicare eligibility, you know, post 65 years of age, once they retire, as a healthcare option. We do have, you know, the Maryland State Retirement System. However, this is, you know, something that is an added benefit, and it's no cost to the employer. It's very similar to our deferred comp plan, where it's, you know, strictly voluntary, no annual fees for the employer, no maintenance. It's more of just passing along this resource to employees when they're ready to retire. So I just thought that this would be an awesome benefit to add to our benefit package, and wanted to know, you know, what your input was and to seek approval to add it to our benefits.
Okay. Council members have any questions?
I guess just functionally, how does this work? Do you have to retire from the town to get these benefits?
So it's that is a good question. I don't think you do, but it depends upon if wherever they do go and they do retire. You know, they can certainly reach out to AMWINS. Like I said, it is a voluntary, no cost to the employer, so I would assume that they would, you know, offer to take any retiree for that benefit. But it's just information that was provided to me from Legit, and it's somebody that they, you know, a company they support.
All right.
Do our employees, I'll just pick on the white-haired guy over there. If he retires tomorrow, he would just go to them, and he could possibly get this program.
So it is a post 65 years of age. So there is an age, okay, you know, eligibility.
Okay.
but that is something that when he turns 65, if he doesn't have Medicare, it is an option to look into.
Okay.
All right. So you're seeking approval of the voluntary AMWIN's voluntary retiree health care program. If there's no other questions, I'll accept the motion to approve.
I make a motion to approve this.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, great find.
Next we have end of year decisions. Carolyn, is that something you're gonna be running with here?
I can.
Okay.
Yep. So each year, the council makes some end-of-year decisions for holidays for employees, and I'll just go through them real quick. And like I've noted on here, these can be adopted individually, partially, or all of them all at one time. So we, a few years ago, made the change to, we used to block off meters for like 2 weeks around Christmas time. It was changed by the council a few years ago from the day of the Christmas parade through Christmas to bag meters to allow, visitors to come and not have to worry about paying for meter fees to shop downtown. The other thing that we have done is typically we have Christmas Day off and there's a half day for Christmas Eve that we have been offered or that has been offered to employees. There is a holiday bonus. We usually do a $15 Acme gift card for Thanksgiving and then a $100 bonus for each employee for Christmas. We typically have a Christmas breakfast for employees, and it would be, if the council approves it, would be December 11th, and we may or may not hold it at the wharf. It may not be. There may not be enough room for everyone to spread out. We may have to look at another option. And then cancellation of the second meeting in December, and that's some years is so canceled.
Let's tackle those four first. The one thing I wanted to discuss is the cancellation of the December 17th, 2020 meeting. I think we only need one meeting in December. Steve is going to be on vacation the first meeting in December. So my recommendation would be let's have the first meeting in December, or let's cancel the first meeting in December, which is the 3rd, and move that and actually have the meeting on the 17th. One of the reasons that I want to do that as well, that I'm going to propose that we do that, is before the election, we were presented with a new set of a fee schedule. And we tabled that fee schedule for this council to be able to make decisions on that. And it was tabled for the first meeting in December. So I think that if we do this, maybe Steve could send out the proposed fee schedule. Council members will have kind of a month or so to look at it, absorb it, ask questions, and then we'll be able to tackle it on the 17th. So I don't know how everybody feels about that.
That's fine by me.
Okay.
Sounds good.
All right, so why don't we take these four? Can I take a motion to approve the four Christmas leave, holiday bonus, Christmas breakfast, and the cancel the December 3rd meeting?
I'd just like to suggest perhaps a full day, Christmas Eve, giving the town employees the full day. It is a Thursday, nice full 4-day weekend. I'm not just to throw it out there as a suggestion to maybe make this a little better package of benefits for the staff.
Put that in the motion. I think that's a good idea.
All right.
Yeah. Cool.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, so we have a motion and a second to allow for a full day of Christmas Thursday, December 24th, in addition to the regular holiday on the 25th. Holiday bonus of $100 plus a $15 Acme gift card. The employee Christmas breakfast, location to be determined. And then cancellation of the December 3rd, 2020 council meeting. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. A couple other additional items to consider.
One second.
I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
I know the county uses this area. They have a Christmas party here every year for the employees, and they hold it like from like 11:30 to 1. Could we maybe possibly approach, I'm just making this suggestion, approach the county since we do use this for our meetings, possibly this could serve?
The problem is this room's not big enough, right?
Yeah,
the room at the wharf is actually bigger than this.
Oh,
and it's a sit-down breakfast, right? It's a great event, right?
I didn't know whether the logistics of it. How's that?
Yeah, this room isn't big enough for...
Okay.
Yeah.
She's looking at alternate venues.
Well, right.
But that's a great idea, right?
Because,
Okay. Carolyn, do you want to discuss the two other things or the other items that we've got on here?
So every year we have an appreciation dinner for all of our volunteers on our boards and commissions. And it typically is held at the American Legion. And we provide dinner, a buffet dinner for our volunteers and a gift. And some past gifts we've had sweatshirts and Tervis tumblers and really cool umbrellas, blankets. And then we also give them each a $20 Centreville dollars, which they can use at any business in town. So this to consider would be the a date for the appreciation dinner, if that would work. And then if anyone has any suggestions, and you don't have to give them to me tonight, but any suggestions for gifts, because it's hard to come up with new ones every year.
We're running out, right?
We're running out. So it's hard. Masks, yeah. Yeah, we actually did talk about that.
Yeah.
So.
I enjoyed the umbrella.
Yeah.
That is good.
Yeah.
Especially in your car.
Right.
Do we have any questions, or is there a motion to approve January 23rd as the annual appreciation dinner, volunteer appreciation dinner?
What day of the week?
It's a Saturday.
Saturday.
Okay.
Make
and
a motion.
We typically have had it the week before, which is Martin Luther King weekend, and a lot of people go away that weekend, so we've lost some people. So I pushed it back, or pushed it out an extra week. I think we try not to. We try to avoid the same night as the Goodwill's appreciation dinner, which I think is usually
early
that
January.
second Saturday. So then the following weekend would be Martin Luther, and then this would be the weekend after.
Okay. Is there a motion?
I make a motion that we accept this, and Carolyn will get all the good suggestions.
All right, is there a second?
Second.
There's a motion and a second for January 23rd, 2021 as the annual volunteer appreciation dinner. Any further discussion?
Yeah, a question. I mean, do we think people are going to want to come to this?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I think we should approve it, and then we get a play by year, right? So if we have to cancel it, then we'll have to cancel it, you know, or we can look at, you know, maybe we got to get a bigger venue or something like that, right? So.
Right.
When I first was on the Planning Commission way back when, it was actually held down at Annie's, right? And they've got a big, big area. The town moved it here into town because we wanted to support local businesses and we wanted to support the local. And I've had a great, I think the Legion does a fantastic job. But, you know, I think it's important we do whatever we can to give back to the volunteers. But we also need to be sensitive this year, so.
And we can do a email survey to see how many people would be interested, and you know, we can do that.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right.
Before we move on, I mean, can we talk about the parking meters? You know,
sure.
Seems like a revenue stream that we could use. I guess I just want to take the temperature of the council and see, you know, if what folks think about bagging the meters for a month.
Been a tradition, hasn't it been, for a number of years, Carolyn? Well, to work with the local businesses. To bring people down.
Yeah, like I said, it used to be for about 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Right before Christmas, and then I don't remember how many years ago, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, the council changed it from the day of the Christmas parade through December. So.
What's the monthly revenue of the parking meters? Does anybody know?
So these days, you know, I think we've really slowed down with COVID. Not as many people are coming in. So I don't know what the actual revenue is going to be. But I will tell you that in all of my experience, if we don't bag the meters, we're getting hit by the local businesses saying, it's Christmas time, you know, can't you get people down here to spend? So
I appreciated my discussion with Steve this week, and he brought up a point that, and I know I've been parking downtown, used to see a parking meter enforcement officer that isn't there anymore. And I've seen a lot of, I don't want to say scofflaws, but besides a lot of people not coming down, I think there's a realization out there that tickets are not being given, is what I'm saying.
So I think so, maybe that's something we can discuss with the chief during his report, because I would agree, right? I mean, we as a council have a policy of very strict enforcement.
No.
COVID came, and it just, we, you know, we're just totally backed off of that. But yeah, I think that's... whenever the time is right to enforce that.
Just to answer Councilman Klein's question about the revenue, typically, of course, pre-COVID, in the past, I think it ranged somewhere between $25,000 to $30,000 a year.
You said $22,000 to $30,000 a year?
Yeah, but if, I don't know, I'm sentimental for Christmas, and I really appreciate my local businesses. And they're going to draw people down, and I think it's a spirit of goodwill, okay? We're appreciating our employees. We're appreciating, all sorts of people. Why not appreciate our businesses and our citizens? So, like Steve said, it's like, what, $20,000 a year? Quick math, that's maybe less than $2,000 a month. So, I don't know. I'm just saying it's the spirit of Christmas, the holiday season, and I am, leave it at that.
The way this policy is in effect is it will be bagged from the 4th to the 25th unless the council makes a policy to change that. I'm happy to leave it the way it is. I mean, we could take an informal poll here if we want to change it, but okay. All right, next we have a letter of support from the YMCA. Steve, do you want to do this? Or you want me to talk about it?
Yeah, essentially the YMCA is proposed to break ground in the spring of the year, and they have submitted a grant application to the state of Maryland, $1 million grant, and the council, what you have before you is a letter of support for that application for that grant money.
Okay. So this has been a long time coming, right? I mean, many of us have seen this thing come through, and they've raised a lot of money already, and they're really on track. So I think this would be they've already put this grant application in, and Robbie Gill had called and asked if we would put this in. So I'm certainly in favor of it. Do we need a motion to approve this? You want a motion to approve it?
We can do that.
Anybody want to make a motion to approve this letter?
Make a motion to approve.
I'm sorry?
I make a motion to approve the letter.
Second. All right, so we have a letter. We have a motion and a second to approve this letter sent out to Governor Hogan, Peter Franchot, Comptroller Franchot, and Secretary Brinkley. Is there any further discussion?
Just to mention that Robbie is planning to come to the council meeting on November 19th for an update on the project.
Okay, that's great. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? No? Okay, let's get that letter out. Carolyn, you have the official copy. We can sign it tonight. Is that right?
I do.
Okay. Letter of support / cash match for the Stories of the Chesapeake mini grant.
I'll talk about that real quick. So Paige Tillman, our economic development manager, submitted a grant to Stories of the Chesapeake and for in the amount of $2,500. So this is to partner with the Women's Museum to develop print materials and market an exhibit that they are planning for to open on, I believe it's January 15th, Martin Luther King's birthday.
Very good.
So she is requesting the council to approve a cash match for $1,000. She has received a match. As long as she receives the grant, she's received a match from the Upper Shore, I always get the name wrong.
Regional Council.
Yes, thank you. Upper Shore Regional Council, a match of $2,500 as well. And then is asking the town for $1,000. So
the if anyone doesn't know, the Stories of the Chesapeake is a nonprofit here on the Eastern Shore. They provide a lot of small grants. Elaine had mentioned earlier that they had gotten a grant. The town has gotten grants for wayfinding signs, for an effort to do some heritage planning over at Pennsylvania Avenue, as well as down at the wharf. And we've partnered very well with them. They've been really good at providing grants. So, here we are. It would be $1,000 of the town's money to leverage the Upper Shore Regional Council of $2,500 and the grant of $2,500. So, $5,000, and this would really go a long way. I think it's a great exhibit as well.
And it would also include some in-kind time for Paige as well.
Yep. So. Okay.
So this is $5,000 of non-town money and $1,000 of town money?
That's correct.
$6,000 to develop and print materials, is that right?
It's a little more detailed. I think it's to print materials to create the exhibits that will be, so the exhibit that they're going to hold is at Locust Hill in the little brick, there's the little brick building there. So to develop the panels as well, that would be on there, as well as marketing material that the town would use, and print materials for the exhibit, so.
I assume when the materials are developed, we would work with the businesses here in town to make sure the word gets out, because that will bring people to Centreville. Mm-hmm. I don't want to, I hate to make assumptions, but that's just a plan.
Correct.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, we've got a letter in front of us. Is there a motion to approve the $1,000 and support letter? Is that a motion?
No, it was not.
Okay.
I make a motion that we support this. It's a very good economic development activity, and it's historical. It's tourism. It helps our businesses in January.
All right, we've got a motion. Do we have a second?
I second.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the $1,000 cash as well as the signing of the letter. Is there any further discussion on this?
Yeah, I just want to make since we've been sitting here in our first town council meeting of these five people, we've spent money on an employee benefit package, which I'm fully supportive of. Obviously, we've pretty much committed to spending money to appreciate our volunteers. We've given back revenue from the
meters,
parking meters, and that, just sitting here, we've spent thousands of dollars. Just note that for the record, maybe.
I've also noticed in the packet there is, oh, here it is. Town Council of Centreville donations list. Steve brought it up, and I'm just saying, I historically, over the last, looks like 6 years, we've been around, averaging around $5,000 a year. I'm just saying that I get what Steve is saying, that we've passed some largesse out there, but I think it's good spending of the funding, and it's not something that the town, even though there are four new council members, I see it here. It's been done in the past, and I think it's an investment. I'll just say that.
Okay. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
4-1. Discussion of board and commission appointments. I had Carolyn print out what our current vacancies are and the total seats that we have. So one of the jobs of the town council is to make appointments to our volunteer boards and commissions. And we've got a considerable number of seats that are open. Some of those have come because members of those volunteer boards have now been elected to office. And I think that it's incumbent upon, at least my experience has been, that it's incumbent upon the sitting council members to really go out there and beat the bushes, right? I know that I've been able to go out there and find a lot of people, but we're always in need of additional volunteers. We've actually changed some of the ordinances to allow for alternates so that, for example, the Planning Commission has 7 members. If you lose a Planning Commissioner, it's good to have kind of the farm team ready to go who has been sitting in on meetings and understands how the Planning Commission works, so that day one they're not having to make a huge decision. So we've got, as it stands right now, I believe it's 11. There's 11 open positions at least. The Park Advisory Board it really doesn't have a limit on the number of people that are there, and I really think that they can use all hands on deck if at all possible. So the point of bringing this up tonight is I want to make sure that council members know go out there and meet with people, right? In the past, what we've done is when someone would put in an application for whatever board it may be, we would then hold a closed session interview, 15 minutes or so per person. You're certainly welcome to get together with that individual on your own if you want, but we would typically try to do, if there's more than one candidate and there's only one position, we would try to interview that person in a closed session and then kind of discuss it and then make a formal motion in an open session. So we've got at least, I think, two applicants for the Parks Advisory Board right now. I would recommend that we have a closed session before our next meeting to do some interviews. And in addition, right, I think it's important that we go out and we continue to look for additional people who are interested in the Parks Board, additional people who are interested in the Planning Commission, Board of Zoning Appeals as well, all of these, right? Economic Development Authority, I mean, Steve, you know, right? We have not been able to get a quorum to attend that meeting to actually conduct business. So, you know, that's kind of sad.
I have to go, how should I say, seek people. Mm-hmm. Is there a typical time and date that these meetings are held, or is that up to the individual commissions or boards?
Well, so
when you ask somebody, the meeting is at 10 o'clock in the morning, I mean, you're limiting your...
Correct.
So, yep.
So yeah, there are. And in fact, Carolyn can get you that information, or Steve, or I certainly can get you as well, right? Planning Commission is the third Wednesday of every month. Okay. Board of Zoning Appeals is on an as-needed basis, right?
That's fine.
Yeah, so I just want, so because for people who are out there listening, right?
So if I want to go recruit, I go to my wonderful town clerk.
We'll just, Carolyn, she'll furnish a list that shows what the typical schedule is.
Send it to us in an email. Mm-hmm. How's that?
Yep.
I mean, that's easy.
You know, and again, some of these are greater time commitments than others, right?
Oh,
the
yeah.
regular boards like the Planning Commission, Board of Zoning Appeals, and CETA, they meet regularly. Personnel Review Board, I don't think, has met to discuss a personnel issue since we created it, right? I mean, it's...
They just have an annual meeting.
They have an annual meeting. Yep.
Yeah.
So to that end, one of the other things that I want to talk about, and I'm going to actually like to present an ordinance to modify the Board of Supervisors of Elections. So we have three members right now. I really think we need to increase that to five, right? The Board of Supervisors of Elections, in the past 2 years, we've had somebody was missing. So the entire burden of the election process, which, right, I mean, it was huge this year, it was huge last year, is falling on two people, and then we got to scramble for some volunteers. This way, if we were able to expand it out to five, even if one or two people couldn't make it, we're still going to have enough, right? In addition, the other change that I want to make, and I'll present this again in an ordinance at our next meeting for a first reading, is that the Board of Supervisors of Elections are appointed in February. Now, that was typically done because our elections were in April.
Right.
So I think we need to kind of move that from February to, what month would you say, probably August, just so that they can get together and meet and choose a chairman.
It could be along with the regular, now they could go in the regular cycle of April for all the other
April.
Appointments.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So that would work.
Mm-hmm. And I think you got to factor in the summer season
yep.
where people go away. So if they meet before, and then we have the election in October, things can happen.
Oh, they usually, because the cutoff is August so they have to meet within, we meet within that week after the cutoff so they can start. Their process.
All right, so again, I just brought this up because I wanted everyone to start thinking about all the open positions that we have now. And
that was one that you were under consideration. You had another idea?
Well, the two things that I wanted to talk about were increasing the number of members on the elections board and changing the date when they actually get installed.
Okay, all right.
I guess I would just flag for, like, the Centreville Economic Development Authority, I guess I've got a question of, if folks aren't coming to these things for months and months, if let's say they go a year and they haven't shown up, right, what action can we take to fill that seat with somebody who is going to show up?
There was an ordinance actually that was passed last year that someone from the Economic Development Authority can come to the council if they miss more than three meetings and request a replacement.
So I think it's if they miss more than three meetings
in
like
a calendar year.
Without giving notice or just not showing up, then they come to the council and say, council, this person has missed it, and then it's up to us to decide Do we want to remove them?
Oh, the CEDA comes here, not that person.
Correct,
sorry.
So that's one of the boards that allows that, right? Planning Commission, that's not allowed, right? We do not have the ability to remove someone if they don't show up. But CEDA has that specifically written into their, and that's a state law, right? So that's a state thing.
Carolyn, Tim says it's an ordinance. Is it in the charter or in the, where is it right now?
It's in the code, actually.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the code gets updated every time we pass an ordinance. Is that what I'm understanding?
Yeah, I think they do it. I think on the e-code, they do it once a year, I think, once or twice a year.
Actually, online, they'll do it as soon as they will update, put new ordinances, resolutions on there. You'll see new, I think it just says new legislation, but it's actually updated in the code once a year. I submit once a year for codification.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
And all that stuff is available on the
I know.
It was just updated. The 2019 ordinance would have been in this last update that we just did.
Are there any further questions or comments on boards and commissions at this point? So can we put it down on the books to have a meeting if the candidates are available, the applicants are available, 6 o'clock on whatever our next meeting is? Does that work? So what we would do is we would meet here.
Right.
Maybe there would be additional people that would come that might apply, and we'll ask, you know, if we do 15 minutes each, that's typically plenty of time. You know, we might be able to get two or three or four in at that point. So 6 o'clock here.
So will you draft, you said you're going to draft the ordinance and then you'll email it out to us before the meeting?
Yeah. So what we're talking about now is just doing interviews for the next meeting.
Yeah.
But then the ordinance, I'll present it at a first reading at our next meeting.
That's fine.
It'll be included in our packet.
And so we'll get a final vote on it into 2021.
Correct. Yep. It'll
so reading, and then it has to be two more.
Yep.
I'm just understanding the process.
Yep.
That's the process.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Next, we have tree lighting ceremony. Who wants to take this? Shelby?
Yeah, I can take it.
All right.
I really just wanted to see what the rest of council's ideas and opinions are about having a tree lighting ceremony this year. I think there's ways that we can do this with, you know, keeping COVID in mind, keeping social distance, making everyone social distance. And I mean, I think that it's, you know, a really nice start to the Christmas holiday. So I'd like to see us do something for the town. I know that they've had carolers in the past. So if that's something, if we want to do the tree lighting, I think that's something that we need to reach out to them now and set that up and then get the word out.
I think it's a great thing, right? I mean, I hate the fact that we had to cancel our Christmas parade, right? The tree lighting ceremony has become a big hit, but because it's outside and we can spread out a lot further, I think it's manageable, right?
Yeah.
So I'm fully in favor, and I think there's going to be some ornaments that are going to be being brought. If we can get a tree and Public Works, I'm sure, Kip, they can get it all set up. I'm fully in favor of doing that.
Likewise. Could we ask... Carolyn had two food trucks for the live farmers market. You know, we could have that, you know, for hot chocolate and, you know, people have something of refreshments.
We typically provide that.
Okay.
The night of the tree lighting. I was going to suggest maybe keep the hot chocolate and the hot apple cider and forego the cookies that everyone just picks up off the trees.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Good call. Maybe just keep the drinks and then, you know, forego the cookies.
Okay. Shelby, what date were you thinking about? Typically, it's the Wednesday or Tuesday before the parade.
Wednesday before.
So is that the first Wednesday of December?
That'd be the second?
The second.
December 2nd.
Yes.
Kip, do you think your guys can get together quick enough by then?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is it already on?
Yeah.
It's already on the schedule
I'm eyeballing Elaine that will fit into your scheme.
Yeah, for us, the sooner the better. We'll have the balls ready and covered.
Okay, that's good. Okay, thank you, Ms. Studley.
Yeah, I would think the first Wednesday in December.
Perfect.
So what day is that?
The second.
The second.
December 2nd.
Is there a time that it typically is?
Six.
So I would stick with that.
Yeah, I think that's great. Okay, any further discussion on that?
What time was that?
6 p.m.
Okay. 6 p.m. I'm going to move on to correspondence now. We do have a request here from the YMCA of the Chesapeake to become a sponsor. And as Councilman Hardy had looked out before, we do have a packet here, or a page in our packet about the donations list. If you look through the donations that we've made over the past five or six fiscal years, that amount has gone down considerably. Last year in FY20, we only made $2,600 worth of donations. We actually have $3,000 put in our budget for FY2021.
This year, yeah,
it and got we haven't done any of it. If you look at some of these, right, we typically do it every single year. So the Rotary ad has been one that we have consistently done. Crossroads Community, they didn't have their fundraiser last year, so I don't believe we did it last year, but that's one that we've always given to. So, I mean, I'm in favor of doing a sponsorship here. We have helped out the Y in the past when they did a bike ride, but I'm open to suggestions from the council.
Can I make a request? Our next meeting is the 19th, correct?
Yes.
Yes, right? November 19th.
Since I got the package and by email, and then Carolyn gave me this, can we possibly, what is it, table this?
Table it.
What?
Are you suggesting table it?
Table it so we can look it over, maybe think.
Well, so the issue, if we tabled it, they're needing to print up materials and all of that stuff.
Okay.
I believe the turkey trot is, I don't know what day it is, but it's probably on Thanksgiving.
22nd to
28th. 22nd, okay. Excuse all me. Right, I'm just, well, maybe we can support that, but other...
excuse me.
dividing up the $3,000, we can think about it?
Yeah, oh, absolutely, and that's why I think we have
there's no rush, I mean, but I can see that...
No, I'm not saying we need to divide up the $3,000.
Oh, no. But now? This way we can, instead of rushing to today, are you suggesting we make a decision today, or what?
Yes, they've come to us tonight to...
Oh, on this?
To ask for...
Yeah, okay.
A donation, right?
Okay.
So we need to decide either we're going to make a donation... Or we're not going to.
Oh, for this one.
Just for this one.
Oh.
Not for the rest of it. Nope. Well, no, it's just. And the way that these have gone in the past is we typically haven't made a decision for all of them.
Oh, no, I understand.
As someone would come in for a request, that's when we would actually
do
it.
That's fine.
Yep.
You know, you've been here for how long?
A couple of years.
Yes, a couple of years. So thank you, Steve.
So in the past, we have sponsored the Two Rivers bike ride in the amount of $1,500. A couple of years ago, we did $1,000. You know, if we did that, the town would get some shirts and some entries if we had some people that wanted to go do some running. And but again, I'll take a motion on any level if anybody wants to make one.
So let me get this straight. What exactly is the dollars that they want for us?
They're in the packet there. They range from $250 to $20,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
They are asking for $250 here in the bottom of
$250.
The second sheet.
On the second sheet? Okay. Thank you, Steve. That's
there you
right.
Go.
Yeah. Since we are in favor of getting our YMCA and we're supporting them with letters to the state, I think we would be remiss if we didn't seriously consider the $250 donation to this worthwhile event.
Will you make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we become a $250, whatever level that is, sponsorship.
Building Future sponsor.
Right.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to sponsor the 2020 Turkey Trot as a Building Future sponsor level in the amount of $250. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay. Let's see. We had a letter here from the Chamber of Commerce. We have not done any kind of advertising with them in the past, and then there's another letter as well. Anybody else have any other correspondence? I didn't see anything else. I'm going to move on to the report of the department heads. Town manager?
There is one more.
We get the Symphony Village HOA letter here?
Yeah, I don't think there's any action needed on that. That's just to read.
Yeah, as far as the Symphony Village request, I just plan on responding back, you know, to them and, you know, indicate that the, you know, we'll be monitoring the situation for a longer period of time.
All right, you want to move on to report of department heads? Town manager?
Okay, I've been continuing with the transition process with the council members. The county dredging project that James Wood had come before the council at a prior meeting. They were able to secure the permits to do the dredging project down to the wharf, that started this week. So that's and the town slips are supposed to be included in that dredging project. It's the developer who's responsible for completing the roads and the infrastructure out there in Northbrook in phase three. Their contractor, David Abraham, was continuing to make the repairs to the streets to have that ultimately be dedicated to the town. I know the original schedule was to try to be complete sometime in the month of November, so hopefully they'll be able to meet that goal. We did issue permits for two different companies that will be installing fiber in the community of Northbrook. So I would say their schedule is as soon as they're able to get their utility locate permits cleared, then they'll be ready to start installing the fiber.
All right. Any questions? Moving on to the chief of police.
Good evening. Pleased to announce that there were no reported issues on Halloween. We had our highly visible patrols out on Halloween night, and everything went very smoothly. So that was good to hear. Regarding the parking enforcement, last week, I appointed Sergeant Larimore as our new agency parking enforcement administrator. His responsibilities include now overseeing the parking enforcement program. That includes meters and parking violations. He'll also oversee maintenance of the meters, any repairs that are needed or replacements, and also will be conducting now bi-weekly deposits of meter money. So we are kind of now taking charge of any type of oversight that may have pre-existed and ensuring that our parking meters and any types of parking violations are addressed. On the last page of your packet, council members, you'll find the departmental overview for October of 2020. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have regarding that.
I do have a question, actually. You know, one of the things here you've got highlighted is that the top speed for 2020 captured by a speed camera is 72 miles per hour in a 35 mile an hour zone. I mean, oh my gosh.
Driving on the wrong side of the road at that.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
My gosh.
So I will say that in all my time, speeding has always been the biggest issue that we get complaints for, to that end. So, I mean, I think it's done a great deal that we've had it. We almost kind of don't even think about it. People driving in town now, they have to really slow down. I'd actually really like to see a speed camera out by Y River Upper School. That is a tremendously fast area, and as kids start to come back to school, I think it's important that we do that. We've got a new district engineer, I think, who might be open to the idea, so I'd like to see if we can investigate that as well.
I would perhaps suggest one around Kennard.
Yeah. Well,
excuse me?
A speed camera around Kennard, just to make sure we've got
Kennard. Speed. Oh, okay. All right.
Make sure that we've got some speed enforcement ability around all the schools full time, 24 hours a day.
Are we suggesting, not by officers, but by...
No, the automated speed camera.
Automated speed camera, yeah.
Okay, all right. Yeah. I just wanted to
clarify that. That's all.
But I will say that the officers are conducting speed checks. I mean, they're out there in their little areas, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I met two officers that way already.
Thank you for your donation. Although the town doesn't get any.
I don't know.
If you got a speeding ticket.
It was a very, I've already told Chief Salbury their professionalism and the way they conducted themselves. We as town council people, members, men, women, can be proud of our policemen.
Yep. I am equally as proud of them.
And I even told one that I was going to do it. And I showed up and he happened to be at the front desk. I said I promised and here I am. And I am very proud that we have a wonderful police force. And I'm sure Chief, the integration and coordination between our police force, Sheriff Hoffman, Maryland State Police, and MDTA is exceptional. And I personally have been in county 30 years and 12 here in the town, and I've seen it, and I like to. I know Chief Joe is going to continue that.
Thank you.
Excellent. I just have two other things. You know, the award ceremony that you had the other night, fantastic. I think it's great that you provide that recognition. I think it's something that's really needed. As we start to get the boat slips are going to be dredged, right? We have the official way to get the people who have their boats there out of there. Now, there's been some boats who have been illegally docked on the transient side, and they've been left there for months. We had some enforcement a couple of years ago. It's not fair to the people who are paying for their slips to these people who are not. So, number one, I think if we could go down there and notify these people who are parked there illegally, they got to move their boat because the dredging's coming, and let them know that they're no longer permitted to do that. When we originally had set up and this is for everyone's information, when we originally had built out the wharf and made the transient slippage, it was free all day, but if you wanted to stay overnight, you had to pay. It was $10, and it was like a parking meter kind of thing, automated parking meter thing, and we just never did it right. So I think as we come up next spring, our slips are always full. We're gonna have a newly dredged river. We want to encourage people to come in, but we also want to make sure that the people who are paying the annual slip fee are gonna get a value for their money. So I think that's gonna be something that we need to kind of figure out as a policy of how we're gonna enforce it and what do we wanna do for for that as well. So
now that the wharf has been improved and with the level dock and everything, has there been good signage out there in making sure people understand that this is the, if I want to say, the law that...
Well, when we took the rails down, we removed those signs. So there's not really any enforcement mechanism as of now. Ignorance of the law is not, an excuse. So technically they should know. And I think if you're a boater and you're boating somewhere, you need to know. I know I would never park my boat on somewhere if I didn't know what the rules were, right? Because you're going to end up losing your boat. So I'm not saying that we cite them. I think it's that, number one, we got dredging coming, you got to move your boat. And number two, it's illegally parked.
Would that be something, Steve and Kip, if we could get some one or two signs down there? Or is the dredging company going to be putting up notices?
I'm not sure.
I'm just asking.
Somebody's going to get in touch with them.
I figured Carolyn was probably going to cover it in her report.
Okay. I got nothing more for the chief, so thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else have anything for the chief?
Thank you.
I'm going to move on to Director of Public Works at C on my agenda here, so we'll get to you. You're F. You should have put yourself first.
No, and I'll go last.
Save the best for last.
That's right.
This is just short and sweet. Wanted to let you know the little free library has been put up down at the Wharf Park. It was put up this morning. The group that does it is the Women Educators, retired and current. They've already put the books in it. So, we've had it for a while to put up, and then COVID hit. And so we're finally got it up. So anybody that knows about it and wants to use it, please go for it. It's on the left-hand corner of the parking lot for the Wharf Park, right there next to the parking lot, but towards the playground. So you'll see it.
Thank you for putting that up. Carolyn, to that end, could you get in touch with them and see if they want to do if we can get a photo op and put it in the paper? And if you don't have time, I'm happy to reach out, but maybe one where we can get the council there. And
I can take care of that.
Kip?
My daughter's one of them.
Perfect, okay.
And if they, I was just thinking too, if they have, I think we may have done it when they first came to us, but if they've got information, I can even send it out in an email blast.
Yeah, that'd be great. Okay. Anybody have any questions for Kip?
I just had one question. Do you know what date the tree is going up?
The tree?
Yeah.
It'll probably be the Tuesday before the tree lighting.
Okay.
So it would be, that's it, first.
The first.
Yeah, that'd be like around Thanksgiving then.
The day before the tree lighting.
Day before.
Oh, day before. Okay.
September 1st.
All right.
Yep. Okay. Anything else? Human Resources Manager.
I don't have much. just wanted to kind of keep everyone posted that we, you know, currently have three police officer vacancies that we're currently running ads on Indeed and Maryland Municipal League website. I am also currently working on some draft policies for future review and trying to get some updates of the personnel manual in certain sections, so hopefully that'll be forthcoming.
Okay.
But other than that, just handling personnel-related matters.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, has the council received a copy of the personnel manual? New council members? Can we?
Yeah.
Okay,
did
okay.
The
orientation
yeah.
manual.
It's in the what part of your packet that you got? Okay, great.
So I don't want to say I'm an expert, but if you want to run anything, I've dabbled in it a little back okay. in a past life.
How's absolutely. That?
All right.
Hey, all hands on deck.
God help me. I volunteered.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Town clerk.
So we received word from James Wood with Queen Anne's County, the public landing supervisor, that they were going to start dredging and that they would possibly be dredging our slips. That's correct, right, Steve? In about 3 weeks. So I drafted and sent letters to our boat slip holders. They were actually all emailed the letters tonight, and the hard copies will go out tomorrow and CC James Wood on them. So they are aware that they need to remove their boats. We have right now one boat that is docked at the transient, in a transient tied up to cleats. And we do have the information on that person, and I will contact them, but I know who it is, and give them a call and let them know that they need to move it, and also let them know about, we do have still have the $10 fee. We are lucky enough that a lot of people do call Town Hall and say, can I come in, and is there any way I can tie up, and we let them know that yes, we used to have a payment system. You can, if you're local, you can come in and pay your $10. You can call and pay over the phone with a credit card. And we've had a lady that has used it probably 5 or 6 times over the summer and has called every time and paid. We typically get the boat information and we send that to the police department so that they're aware that boat is there.
Fantastic.
It's $10 a day. The transit fee is $10.
$10 a night. So it's from 7 at night till 9. No, I'm sorry. 9 at night till 7 in the morning is how it reads. If they're there just during the day, it's free. But if they're spending the night, it's $10.
We have any sense how long the vessel's been there?
The one that's there right now, I don't know how long it's been there. I didn't realize until today that it was there. So, yeah.
How many transient slips do we have?
We can tie up about, I think we have 5 or 6 cleats.
Okay.
And it's typically by the foot. So, I mean, depending on how your boat is, how long your boat is, but we could probably get, I mean, if you include the pocket park all the way at the south and right next to the floating dock, you could probably get 10 boats okay. in there.
I'm not a boater, so I have no idea how all that works. But yeah.
One Bishotti boat and then all the rest.
and are there signs there that indicate, I mean, maybe Bob asked this already in a different way, but are there signs there that indicate it's $10 a night?
There is not. We used to have a pay-by-phone system down there for the transient docks. The pay-by-phone system was actually out of Canada. So by the time we paid the exchange rates, we didn't get very much in our account. And the system didn't work very well. And it was, we would get calls saying it's not working. At that time, we didn't take credit cards either. So it just kind of went by the wayside. And yeah, it's been discussed as something that we need to look at, figuring out how to do that. A new system. I don't know if there's any type of metering system that may work for that, or some other kind of pay by phone that would work well for that. And it, you know, is a good discussion to talk about for the upcoming spring.
Yeah, and you know, we're going to get the decking all replaced. That may, and now that the dredging is coming through, it might be a good opportunity for us to figure out the policy, how to figure that out, and then put a couple signs up.
And we also it's gonna be more popular. And I'm not sure exactly where it's located along there, but we will have water and electric available for our slips. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's available for transients or if it would be, or
not the way that it's designed. Right?
Gotcha. Yeah. So, and you know, if we were to do that, then maybe a different fee should be, you know, considered. Yeah.
Okay.
For transients.
This dredging, is this the whole Corsica River or just in our end of the Corsica?
Steve
just
or
in
Tim
our
can,
end.
Yeah.
It goes out to the point.
No, okay.
And then it's deep enough. Yeah.
So is this a private contract or is this Corps of Engineers, or I'm just wondering.
It's the county is doing it, so I'm not sure of the specifics of how it all worked out.
Private company.
Yeah, so they got a grant.
No, okay.
And it's they hired a private company to do it through a bid system, but the Army Corps of Engineers are the ones.
Oh yeah, I know. I'm just asking.
Yeah,
you know, it's like Steve always brings up, who's paying for water? How are we doing it? And I appreciate that.
Yeah,
and so. This is a good one for us, then.
No, it's going to be fantastic.
Cooperation between the county and the town. Very good.
Anything further? Anybody have any questions? Second Citizens Forum. Does anybody want to speak for 3 minutes? You're welcome to come up. Introduce yourself again.
There's nobody here.
Come up and sit.
Speak on my personal now.
Just please introduce yourself again. And
my name is Elaine Studley. I live at 201 South Liberty, and the rest of the time I live here. I just want to say thank you to all of the shiny new faces. 2 years ago when I started this process, I would never have guessed the diversity on this panel or the level of talent, and I am just so beyond thrilled and excited. So I just wanted to start with a moment of gratitude and really say thank you to the people who are seated here and are putting in the time. That's just amazing to me. I thought it was a crazy idea 2 years ago. I still sort of think it was a crazy idea, but I'm glad you're all seated here. I have a thanks to Chief Savory. Liberty, one of the biggest concerns I've had since coming here, and we've often discussed it, is speeding on Liberty. COVID has given us a little bit of a break, thank heaven. It's given us a reprieve, but in the last 2 years, actually prior 2 years to that, we lost two animals, died on Liberty, and one child took a near miss on a bike that just scared the tar out of me. I have clocked trucks at over 50. Now, I know this has a long history of a challenge on Liberty, and that is that we're a state highway and we don't get to have the signage or the speed signs, the speed traps. But I got to tell you, it remains a real concern to me. I had a new puppy and mine got hit as well, so we're now going on 3 people having been hit.
One other comment, as I was going around campaigning and visiting the town of Centreville in the streets, a neighbor of Elaine's made that same concern.
Yeah, we're all terrorized.
She lives on the other side of the street of Liberty, and her concern is that a lot of it is also these big tricked out trucks that they take off from the Water Street light there. And it's boom, they just peel out. And while I don't know what we could do, but it's.
Well, I'm going to tell you that neighbors on Liberty have been plotting to figure out how to handle it themselves, and we're trying to get them not to do it. But What the officers probably don't know is the last time the officers went wailing down to get somebody, we were all on the porches going like this. So, and when somebody gets stopped on Liberty, I get all excited. And then I had one more thing, and that is that I know in going around to the 1,200 homes that we did, we would often come back to the table and have a conversation about what we had heard and what we had learned. And it was a wonderful experience that I hope never to repeat. But it was also a great learning curve. One of the things that came out of it, the number one concern expressed by people at the time was budget. And because the road work was, very active at the time, everybody's biggest fear. He took one of my minutes. The other concern was that sometimes was talked about was transparency. And what this group learned and what it had to say, I think, is a worthy listen. And that might be a consideration at some point in the future. The question of whether or not we could have Zoom, I know most of us are really still dormant. My board is still hibernating. Nobody really wants to come out. Nobody wants to be present. But I would hate to lose the momentum we gained over a two-year period of getting the whole community excited and involved. So I would love to have Zoom. I know it's another expense. And if we could figure a way that we could get that expense paid for you or build some program up to get that expense, I think Zoom, maybe not right now, but into the future would be worthy for someone who's stuck at home. I think you'd get a lot. I know it's great at the county. And so I'd love to see Zoom incorporated to this. I'd love to know how much more, before I shoot my mouth off about paying for something, I'd like to know how much more Zoom would be.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. No other public comment? We'll close that. Now we're going to move into the council roundtable. Again, council roundtable for the new council members. This is when each of you are going to have an opportunity to say what's on your mind or make any reports or discuss anything. So we're going to start out with Councilmember Brown.
Uh-oh. Get the right name there, Tim.
Is it not the right name?
Ananiah.
Councilmember Ananiah. I apologize. Councilmember Ananiah.
Okay, I do have a couple of reports from the Parks Advisory Board meeting that we had on Tuesday. Let's see. The Parks Board voted to use $2,500 from their budget to move the old swing set that's right now at the Public Works Yard to have it repositioned at the wharf, which was always the original plan. So they voted and all agreed to use their budget for that. They also have decided the theme for the Christmas trees on Lawyer Row, and that is Centreville Christmas Memories or Dreams. And Mr. Ryan, one of our board members, has gotten to different Girl Scout troops and garden clubs and different groups in the community, and they will be decorating the trees, which will be very lovely.
Just be on Lawyer's Row?
Yes, that... will just be the 12 trees on Lawyer's Row.
Yeah, okay.
Right now we have the seven trees that we have seven trees and we need five more. So he's asked he's going to go purchase five more trees, and I believe that we'll be refunding him for that.
We usually do each year.
Okay. And then the other thing that was brought up was that there were some comments made by the former council member, Jim, to allow the Parks Advisory Board remaining balance to roll over each year. So that's something they'd like us to discuss to see how,
okay,
if we approve that.
So they don't get much of a budget, and if they don't use it, they lose it. And so I think that's something that we can, I don't know when it would be appropriate for us to discuss, definitely during budget time.
Yeah.
But if they don't use it, to have them, because we've done that for other groups. That's great.
Perfect.
Anything else you want to share?
Nope, that's going
to
be it.
So before we move on to our next person, you had mentioned that you wanted to do a report. I want to add something to the agenda if we can for going forward. I think after correspondence, maybe before the department heads, could we have another section there on reports, council reports? So, Parks Board, Planning Commission, that kind of thing. If your board has met, then you can give a summary. If you don't want to say anything, that's fine too. If that's okay with everybody?
That sounds right. Like a good addition.
All right.
Perfect.
Councilmember Keel.
I don't really have anything. I'm just looking forward to serving the citizens of Centreville.
Perfect.
So.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Hardy.
In going around and during campaigning, and everybody appreciates what the town has done down at the wharf. And I noticed going in and out of the second floor conference room, there's that, it's a business. He has kayak tours, is that correct?
Fishing guide, kayaks.
Yep.
Fishing guide.
Outfitter. Yeah, the outfitter. And other people then were talking about they really appreciated the town redoing the wharf. And I don't want to say I was surprised, but neighbors at Symphony Village, there was a number that would like to have a kayak rack. I mean, we do have a, what is that? That we can,
dock?
Floating dock. But they were thinking there is a, down at the Narrows, I forget what the community is, but they have a rack, just a wooden rack where people can store their kayaks. I don't know. What?
Gibson's Grand is what it's called.
Gibson's Grand. And then there's the one on the other side that's been there forever. But that could be something we might want to factor into the budget, because people, they like going out with their kayaks, maybe even their canoes, because of the recreational nature of our end of the Corsica River.
I think it's a great idea, right? And so there are many communities that do it. I was down in Washington, D.C. not too long ago along their Riverwalk, and they've got that for people who want to rent. One of the things that I learned from Councilmember Ogans of Symphony Village member was, actually maybe this was from Smokey. If you bring up the idea, you own it.
Yeah, so that was smart.
I'd like to put it on you to research the costs.
I'm going to own a lot of things then, Elaine, huh?
Well, you know, when you come up with good ideas, you know, you're going to get that stuff.
So that's fine.
I'd like to see if you could research different types of kayak or canoe launches. Then we can have a further discussion on that. And, you know, people would typically rent them.
Oh, right? Yeah.
And it would be on them. They could lock them up and whatnot. So,
and that's something, besides bringing it to the council, I would also definitely copy Steve.
Yep. Okay.
And work with Kip. Okay. Thank you.
Anything else?
Nope, I'm fine.
Council Vice President Klein.
Thanks. So I'll start by saying I looked on the website a little bit today, and I just want to encourage maybe a spot where we can make just clearly how folks can request time on the agenda if a business person or a community stakeholder or a community leader wants to come in and present on something, particularly, you know, that they want to do for the town. You know, I think it would just be really beneficial to say, you know, we've got a Friday deadline when the agenda is finalized. So, you know, just sort of transparency. I think at some point I'd like to talk about establishing a communications task force or a communications advisory board, or we've got a lot of talent in the community. I think as we all went around and talked to people, there are folks that know how to communicate and they know how to get things out into the community. And I just, I wonder, as we talk about some of these things, how do we communicate better with the community? Perhaps to have a few folks that have some professional experience volunteering a little bit of their time to figure out some of these things, you know, how maybe we can improve the website, how we can take advantage of social media to get some of these great things that the town is trying to do out there in the public eye. And the only other thing that I would mention is, you know, I think we've got to take a good hard look at our salaries, you know, up and down the town in terms of our employees. I know Crystal mentioned that we've got a few vacancies in the police department. And we have got to be competitive with our neighboring municipalities, our neighboring counties. It's critically important to attract the best talent. And I think, you know, if you buy on price, you're going to buy it twice. And I think we just have to take a good hard look at that. I'm happy to lead. I'm happy to take that on. I'm happy to work with Chief Sabori to look into competitive, you know, what other municipalities might be paying. So on all other considerations, candidates are going to go to those other places, or they might leave as quickly as they can to go to those other places, and then we bear the cost of rehiring, training up and down town government, whether it's police officers or public works staff. Sure. So I'd like to join, you know, with a few other council members, maybe all of us, in a pretty comprehensive salary review to make sure we are attracting the best talent we can here in Centreville.
I know Crystal can really help out with that as well. She's got all those statistics.
I second what Steve is saying, because I love the Food Lion parking lot. I ran into Steve Walls there one day, and he told me about they had lost two people in public works. And it's not just the cost of the salary, but as Steve was saying, and both the other Steve mentioned, it's the training. It's the, if you want to call it, sunk costs yep. that we're investing in these employees. And I applaud, you know, our, like, we just lost Corporal
Jackson.
Yeah, Jackson. But he's moving on to a newer career. But that's the type of thing that we maybe, I kind of agree with Steve. That's an excellent idea.
Okay, so you can spearhead that. Would you also be willing to look at the other issue that you brought up in terms of a communications task force?
You bet, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Perfect. I do have a couple of things as well, so...
I'm sorry.
Are you not done? No, keep going.
No, I'm not. I just jogged my memory that we had a meeting, a work session of the Centreville Economic Development Authority that was attended by Chairman Nick Rowden, myself, Paige Tillman, and Carol D'Agostino. You know, as we mentioned earlier, we do have something of an attendance problem. We are going to try. I know I've got to sit down with Chairman Rowden to talk about how we get people turned out to this meeting. We think it's pretty critically important. And they would like to, I can certainly give these updates, but I think Nick and Paige would perhaps like to come in and address the town council at our next meeting. So if I could maybe get some time on the agenda for them to come in and more formally brief some of their plans. I know that they have got a formal economic development plan that they've been working on for quite some time that certainly predates my time. So I'd love to have them come in and take a few minutes.
That's a great idea. And one of the things that we had talked, I think, briefly about was that with all the new council members coming in, we've got a lot of boards and commissions. And I'd like to see if we could have a meeting when the Planning Commission could come in and say, hey, here's what planning is. Mm-hmm. Parks Board come in and say, here's what Parks Board see as well. Can you work, Carolyn and Steve, with those groups to see if we can put them on the agenda, maybe one per night, right, over the next several months, so that by the time that we come to budget session, everybody knows what every group does, what their needs are, all of that kind of stuff. Does that make sense? Including like the cemetery board, right? Even though they're not, you know, one of these, they're kind of an ad hoc committee. I think it's important that they get the opportunity to come in as well, because that's a big budget item. Do you have anything else?
No, sir. Thank you.
Excellent point, Steve.
I have a couple of things here. I'm going to be presenting an ordinance, introducing an ordinance next time for, it's a text amendment to the zoning ordinance to allow for museums in the R2 zone. Now, currently, we do not allow for museums in any zone in the town, but our zoning code does say that does provide for parking requirements for museums within town. So it's kind of a weird thing, right? The two museums that we do have in town predate the ordinance, so they're kind of grandfathered in. We know that Mary Margaret's Women's Museum is going to be moving in and officially taking residence over at Turpin's Farm, and I think it's important that we follow the law and that we provide for a legal way for them to actually do that. So I'll be writing the ordinance and presenting it. I'll make sure that Sharon takes a look at it and for good use. And the way that a text amendment for the zoning code works is it'll get introduced as a first reading within the council. Then it will go before the Planning Commission, and they'll have an opportunity to comment on it. Then it will come back to the town council. We will hold a public hearing, and then we will actually have a second reading, public hearing, second reading, and then we would have consideration.
I assume to follow rules and regulations, whatever, it gets advertised in the newspaper?
Yeah, absolutely. And there's all those,
no,
all
no,
those
I'm rules. Just...
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. So that's pretty much everything I have. This has been a pleasure. We're at 8:25. I think it's been really great. I'm really happy to see everybody raising their hands and being willing to take on those tasks. So please keep coming up with other ideas. Anything else? All right, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everybody.